tonight. Didn't think it was possible for Yale's a cappella scene to get any bigger? Well, this year it did, and the new edition might surprise you.
Plus, 3 years after Battle Hymn of the Tiger Mom, Yale Law professor Amy Chua sits down to discuss her new book, The Triple Package.
Stay tuned for these stories and more, because it's your Yale, your week, and your news.
Hello and welcome to YTV. I'm Raleigh Cavero and today is April 18th, 2014. To begin, we'll go to Madison Allworth in the newsroom for this week's headlines.
Thanks, Raleigh. Today marks the end of another YCC election. For the past 2 days, Yale students have gone online to cast their ballots for next year's executive board. The most contentious race is for president. It's between Ben Ackerman, Michael Herbert, Sarah Miller, and Leah Motzkin. Motzkin is a staffer for the YDN, and Miller currently serves on the YDN board. Three candidates are vying for the vice presidency: Chris Motz, Allison Kohlberg, and Maya Eskelovich-Siegel. The races for the final two positions on the council, finance director and events director, are both uncontested. Those roles will be filled by Connor Feely and Jamie Halberstam. Many students are saying that this is one of the most negative presidential campaigns in YCC history. YCC has not yet announced when results will be released. The cost of attending Yale may keep climbing, but Yale seniors are graduating with less debt than ever before. In 2004, 39% of Yale graduates left New Haven with an average debt of almost $17,000. For last year's graduating class, this number fell to just 15%, with the average borrower owing about $13,000. This trend comes at a time when average student debt nationwide has climbed due to rising tuition and the growth of student loans. In 2012, Yale students graduated with the second lowest amount of debt in the Ivy League behind Princeton. Yale's new residential colleges will now house 54 more residents than previously planned. The design plans were changed earlier this year, and those adjustments replaced some of the college's singles with doubles. This is part of an effort to promote suite-style living and reduce crowding in the existing colleges. The new college's planned population rose from about 850 to 904, which will decrease the number of students being placed in annex housing. The first freshmen will move into those colleges in 2017. Along with new freshmen, there will also be new changes to faculty hiring in the coming year. The Academic Review Committee released a report that recommended changes Yale should make. Most notably, the committee's report suggests that the size of the faculty should remain the same. That's in line with Provost Benjamin Pollack's previous recommendation. Other proposed changes include measures to give individual departments more control over hiring and a new program to promote faculty diversity. This report comes at the end of the committee's two-year review process, beginning in the fall of 2012. It marks the university's first academic review of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences in two decades. For the past 50 years, the Yale Bakery has satisfied Yale's sweet tooth from its headquarters in the basement of Commons. But this summer, the bakery will move into a new home at 344 Winchester Ave. The new location, which is 500 square feet larger than the current space, will feature upgraded cooking equipment and an improved layout. And that's it for this week's headlines. Every year, Bulldog Days presents the chance for student clubs to show what their club has to offer to eager pre-frosh. This week, we sat down with a group that is pushing the boundaries of music and some say has even created its own genre. We go to reporters Michael Leopold and Stefina Yuli to hear more about Yale's very own A Squared, a club that is now 1 year old and also breaking new ground in music.
A Squared is a group of 12 Yalies that are reinventing a cappella by adding Ableton Live, a sound manipulation software, into the usual mix of human voices. They've been able to create a whole new way of making music.
The project is the brainchild of Jacob Reske, who first thought of the idea at the end of his sophomore year. 2 years later, his dream is finally becoming a reality.
I've always had this dream of doing an ensemble where you could combine the flexibility of the voice with like the flexibility of electronic music. And so I wanted to kind of explore that in this project.
Since they first got together just a year ago, A Squared has been snagging gigs at Yale and released 3 self-made music videos on YouTube. Each video has received over 4,500 views.
It's been really amazing to watch this idea that he had just become an actual thing, you know, and watch it grow from the beginning.
Yeah, we've been doing a bunch of different things. We've been kind of crazy all over the place. We did TEDx as well. We were one of their performers.
On top of these gigs, the group has also booked performances on a regional scale. Just last weekend, they were chosen to compete in Boston Sings, also known as BOSS, a regional a cappella festival that promised an a cappella revolution.
They had a great time. You know, it was a completely different experience because they've never competed in a cappella competition. It's every time it's like A Squared is doing something different and new.
It's really interesting to see like how other people were reacting to it and how like the guys were like genuinely like just so surprised and humbled by the experience of like having so many people support you.
The group works its magic by singing live and with a touch of a button can transform their voices into sound effects in real time. The result is a blend of sounds that transcends traditional vocal boundaries.
We didn't even go out to it. We really just kind of came to show off our concept.
Though they didn't end up placing in Boston, the group did earn a standing ovation from surprised audience members.
And as it ended, there was this utter and complete silence. The music cuts out. And we didn't know how we had sounded. We didn't know how they were going to like it. And so there was like, I guess, like a 6-second period, which seemed like forever, of silence. And then the lights came on, and I guess that kind of shook people back into reality, and then they realized what had just happened as they'd wait, and it was a beautiful moment.
All members of the original 5 come from a cappella backgrounds. 4 were Duke's Men, and 1 was from Shades. And though they have a shared respect for the traditional a cappella, they're quick to point out that A Squared is something completely different.
Like what we're doing, kind of vocal looping technology, rather than that being like a continuation of a cappella, I think it's just altogether divergent.
The reason why I'm on the team is not because, you know, I love music, but I personally can't sing for my life. I think the cool thing about A Squared is that we're looking at it as like a whole experience.
But with most members graduating within the next year, these Yalies are now grappling with the question of what the future holds and what direction A Squared will soon take.
We've had amazing support this far. We still have a little ways to go. We're hoping it works out. But we also have stretch goals of possibly going on tour, doing more music videos. I actually have a bus sitting next to my garage that we'd love to fix up and go on tour in.
A Squared is definitely going to be something that is going to exist both at Yale and beyond Yale.
While the future remains unclear, the group is hopeful and on the most part seem very happy to be experimenting with their new art.
To experience their new sounds live, you can catch their next performance at the Schubert Theater next Tuesday. For YTV, this has been Stefina Yuli and Michael Leopold.
Though made up of Yalies, A Squared is an independently run group of student artists. They are seeking funding through a Kickstarter campaign that runs until April 27th.
And most senior film majors wrapped up their thesis projects last semester. But for Ryan Chan, his journey with his mini feature film Acceptance is still going strong. This month, the film was selected for screening at the 14th annual New York Indian Film Festival. That same festival debuted Academy Award winner Slumdog Millionaire. Kristen Mendez and Caroline Pringle tell us how his senior film made it big.
In a few short weeks, this scene will fill the eyes and ears of New York City audiences at the famed New York Indian Film Festival.
We're just incredibly humbled to be part of any film festival because we really believe that they're doing us a huge favor by organizing this event and, you know, helping us sort of get our film out there. It's really, really hard to make a movie, and it's also really hard to get someone to watch a movie because it's 50 minutes of time, or sometimes, you know, 2 hours of time. So we're just really happy for anyone who is interested in showing our film.
To see something I've been involved with and all the people I've worked with have worked really hard on succeed artistically in the sort of festival realm is a really cool thing.
The festival, promoting Indian cinema, will feature films from directors young and old. Other films premiering there will include Brahmin Bulls, An American in Madras, and 3 Shades of Brown. Just 6 months ago, the film was still in the works with co-writer Vishnu Hari and cinematographer Chris Ripley.
It's 50 minutes long, so it makes it extremely hard to program for a film festival. And so we were really worried that we wouldn't get in anywhere. The New York Indian Film Festival, like, we're so grateful to be part of it. I just think, like, you know, the New York Indian Film Festival really fits our target audience for it.
Acceptance tells the story of a Singaporean who lies about being admitted to Harvard to win the respect of his peers. Singapore was just as much a character as it was a location for the film.
The filmmaking process as a whole is just, like, a little bit different. I mean, I've done a number of international shoots, and I mean, even in the U.S., between, like, New York and L.A. and stuff, there's, like, differences. But, like, especially moving outside the U.S., I think you learn a lot about different tricks and ways of getting stuff done from the international crews.
I'm really grateful for, you know, having grown up, you know, in Singapore, gone to an international school. I was an American who lived abroad. I felt like the sort of culture there was so unique, and it didn't really get a lot of, you know, exposure. A lot of people often would say, oh, it's so boring, why would you want to make a movie there, or this or that, but that definitely wasn't my experience. So I really feel like a duty to where I come from, just to try to at least export the culture in some way, because I really believe in it, and I hope other people do too.
Chan hopes the festival screening marks an important step for him toward a bright future in film.
I'm not so sure what's going to happen in the future, but this festival definitely is a launching pad because it's giving us a lot of experience with how the film festival circuit works. This is our first round.
This has been Kristen Mendez and Caroline Pringle reporting for YTV.
Acceptance will premiere at the New York Indian Film Festival on May 6th. Here at Yale, it will make its debut on April 24th.
For most students, summer is an opportunity to travel, accept an internship, or return home after a long year. But Yale athletes must make room for one more activity, summer workouts. For more on the challenges of balancing these workouts with other summer plans, we go to Georgiana Wagman.
For varsity athletes in fall sports, summer provides little relief from the grueling spring training season. With competition kicking off almost immediately at the start of the semester, fall athletes have little choice but to return to campus in peak physical form.
We have to take a lot of time over the summer, whether you're on your own or with the team, and make sure you're working at it and not throwing everything away we did all year.
Some Yale athletes choose to make the balance a little easier by spending the summer months here in New Haven. While here, some take summer classes, accept a job nearby, or simply focus on working out and improving on the field.
I worked for Gatorade doing a marketing job, and beyond that, we worked out 5 days a week with Emil, and that was strength and conditioning, and then we also did our own 7-on-7, and as a kicker and specialist, we worked out on our own as well.
I had access to Payne Whitney, and I can run on the track in Landman, or we could use the sort of like pseudo weight room they set up there. So that was pretty convenient, and I could also play in JLA. We could like set up the nets and play.
No matter where they land, Yale athletes keep an eye out for each other. It's not uncommon for Bulldogs away from campus to meet up for training and practice.
A lot of guys are going to be together. There'll be some guys in DC. There'll be some guys in New York. There'll be a couple of guys in Boston, and those couple of guys will get together and be able to work out together. So it's a little tougher where you're not with Emma with 60 guys every day, but you're able to get it done and figure it out.
Some of Yale's athletes face the challenge of establishing a training regimen in a foreign country where opportunities to train with teammates or other college athletes may be limited. Men's soccer player Connor Lockenbrook was lucky enough to travel with two teammates where he studied abroad in the Czech Republic last summer, making the adjustment a little easier.
We, you know, held each other accountable for making sure we were staying up with workouts.
But Lockenbrook's teammates weren't the only ones helping him improve his game. Local Czech players were eager to include the Americans in their pickup games, giving them a rare opportunity to mix cultural exchange with preparation for soccer season.
It was quite easy to walk down the street and see people playing soccer and ask if we could join. And that was honestly one of my favorite parts of the entire studying abroad experience.
Though following a strict workout regimen while pursuing an enticing summer opportunity is a lot to ask, for Yalies it comes with the territory.
They know that they're going to have to stay on each other and, you know, go through some of the same struggles that I went through to make sure they're standing on top of it.
Usually everyone is like pretty disciplined and usually finds a way to make it work no matter what they're doing.
Although many athletes pursued opportunities outside of New Haven last summer, over 60 football players stayed on campus to train with the team. Even though they worked hard, they were allowed to have a little fun too. For example, after their bench press test, their trainer, Emil, threw them a barbecue to celebrate the occasion.
Thanks, Georgiana. The spring season officially ends following the Heptagonal Championships in women's track and field on May 11th.
Summer seems a long ways away. Finals period is still between us, so.
So true.
So true. So true. And as always, we leave you with our Everybody Has a Story segment. This week, Cody Pomeran sat down with Yale Law Professor Amy Chua, also known as the Tiger Mom. They discussed her new book, The Triple Package, how three unlikely traits led to the rise and fall of cultural groups in America. Here are a few highlights from that interview.
Hi, welcome to YTV and this week's segment of Everybody Has a Story. Yale Law School professor Amy Chua became a household name when she published the New York Times bestseller, Battle Hymn of the Tiger Mother, back in 2011. And she's come out with a new book this year, co-authored with her husband, Jed Rubenfeld, called The Triple Package, how three unlikely traits explain the rise and fall of culture groups in America. And she joins us this afternoon. Professor Chua, thanks so much for being here.
Thanks for having me, Cody.
So let's start off very broadly. For people that may not have picked up the book yet or don't know about it, what is the triple package?
The triple package refers to three qualities that propel individuals and groups to disproportionate success. And the three qualities are, first, what we call a superiority complex. That is a deep-seated sense of exceptionality. You add to that the second element, which is a dash of insecurity, that is a feeling that you're not quite good enough, that you haven't done enough yet. And the third element is impulse control, basically self-discipline and the ability to resist temptation and not give up in the face of failure.
Now these seem like somewhat intangible qualities that are hard to measure. Is one more important than the others? Are these all in the equal playing field?
You need all three of them. So if you just had a sense of superiority, that's more likely to lead to complacency or smugness. I'm so great, I don't need to do anything. What's really interesting is when you combine that sense of superiority with insecurity, that's when you get this kind of chip on the shoulder mentality, which actually, if you kind of just like read all the bios of super successful people, you will be amazed how it comes up almost every time. You know, like Steve Jobs, always described as a kind of narcissistic personality, you know, like huge ego, thought he could transform the world. But all of his close friends also described him as being deeply insecure, maybe from being an orphan. And they all said he had a kind of a chip on the shoulder mentality that made him feel like he had to prove himself and work harder than everybody else. And so you need those two to generate drive. And I think a lot of the other accounts of success don't actually account for that. Like what, you know, you can be super, super smart, but what makes you hungry for more? You know, who keeps working? And then the third element, impulse control, is necessary to turn that drive into reality. I mean, you could be very driven, but if you give up or you don't have the, you know, kind of the mentality to stay at it, then that won't work either.
Now, how do you want this book and this thesis to contribute to the debate about American decline? I mean, what are the practical implications here? Have we lost the triple package? Is it something we should try and regain?
Well, we start off by saying in our last chapter that America was born a triple package nation. So clear, you know, that sense of exceptionality. Everybody knows about the city on the hill. At the same time, America had a real insecurity vis-a-vis Europe. There were these aristocratic monarchies, and there was always this need, we're going to prove that our democracy is better, that our system is better. And then we also inherited this very strong puritanical streak, the impulse control. But what we do say is that after becoming a hyperpower, you know, which is the first time that the United States has not been an underdog, yeah, basically success contains the seeds of its own erosion, right? After the fall of the Soviet Union, we were left the one power standing, and then you can kind of, you lose some of that insecurity, we're not an underdog anymore, and as we say, you know, maybe by the year 2000, maybe what we had mostly left was just the superiority complex, and without a little bit of insecurity, this need to prove yourself to leaven that, that can just be a recipe for complacency. And so ironically, with the rise of China and a lot of, you know, recent problems, this could be, you know, a silver lining, like, you know, maybe, you know, maybe it's a wake-up call. But the real message of the book is actually at the individual level. This is the biggest misunderstanding of the book. The triple package is not exclusive to any ethnicity or religion. It's accessible to anybody. So our idea is that if we are serious about addressing inequality in this country, we have to, of course, try to level the economic playing field, but we have to try to be honest that some groups or some types of behaviors also contribute to some groups being more successful. You know, like if you have certain study habits or certain attitudes, that leads to more success. So let's, instead of saying culture is taboo, we can't talk about this, you're stereotyping, our idea is let's open this up, let's debate it. People can reject it, but if we really want to address poverty and education reform, we should be trying to level the cultural playing field as well as the economic one.
Sure, but in the book, I mean, you talk about the fall of the Soviet Union, but you also talk about in the book the 1960s and, you know, the rise of the hippie generation, and that maybe this led to some complacency, psychedelic culture, free creativity. But this seems to be the spirit that is at the base of success in Silicon Valley. I mean, you mentioned that Steve Jobs is someone you think had the triple package. So don't those two ideas kind of run counter to each other?
Well, this is the fun part about the last chapter. We're lawyers, and my co-author, my husband, is a constitutional law professor, and what we say is that America has always had these two competing strands. The Declaration of Independence is the rebellious thing, right? That's the live in the moment, pursuit of happiness. That's in the Declaration of Independence. A more freewheeling, energetic drive. The Constitution is all about impulse control. There's no mention of the pursuit of happiness in the U.S. Constitution. It's all about how can we make this nation last, you know, and how can we rein in tyranny of the majority? What if the majority wants to do something that's bad for the country? So it's these two impulses that I think explain American dynamism in Silicon Valley. I mean, Steve Jobs was very much a rebel, but he was incredibly self-disciplined and resilient at the same time. He had very, very, very big dreams, but he also had the ability to kind of keep absorbing failure. So I think that's, I think it's completely consistent with the triple package.
Well, let's end with the speed round, which we always do with these interviews. It's just a couple quick, fun, lighthearted questions. The first one, actress you would want playing you in a movie version of Battle Hymn of the Tiger?
Lucy Liu, who's also a friend.
And your husband?
The James Bond guy.
Daniel Craig.
Daniel Craig.
Number three, if you were to add one more quality, making this the quadruple package, what would come in the close fourth?
Generosity.
And last question, I know some of the law students you have. How much of the law students at Yale Law School do you think possess the triple package?
100%.
They'll be glad to hear it. Professor Amy Chua, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me.
And thank you for joining us for YTV. I'm Cody Pomerantz, and this has been Everybody Has a Story. See you next week.
To watch the full interview, go to the YTV website under the Features page.
And that's it for us tonight. We'll see you next Friday at 3 p.m. For now, take a minute to watch Yale Med School's version of Let It Go from the Disney hit Frozen.
You might feel some sympathy for them with our own finals looming on the horizon. Thanks for watching. It's your Yale, your week, and your news.
So much free time and so much to do. The Yale system rumors, they were true. You're not a score for us to be. Just one top. always bothered me anyway.